The reasons I'm running for U.S. Senate really go all the way back to 2008. I'm not going to give you the full version of the story, but I was on vacation and I picked up a book about Hillary Clinton. It's called Hell to Pay. And it raised or provoked some thoughts and questions like, the only thing necessary for the triumph of evil is for good men to do nothing. How is it that we have the leaders that we have, and what does that say about the future of our country? And it was kind of a long and involved process, about 7 or 8 months of prayer, before I began to, my life began to move in a completely different direction, and I made a decision to run for Congress at that time.
Why is it important to defeat an incumbent Republican in the Senate race?
I believe the nation's going in the wrong direction. A lot of people believe that, and I believe if we want to change the direction of the country, we're going to have to change the leadership, to some degree, of the Republican Party. Now, I believe in the greatness of America, the greatness of our heritage, and the Democratic Party kind of likes the direction we're going in already. I believe the origins of American greatness are found in Christianity, capitalism, and the Constitution. And if we want to get the ship going back in that direction, well, we got to send people to Washington who are committed to those kind of ideas and principles and are willing to fight for them. I've been blessed with a good education. I believe I have the ability to articulate what it is that is harming the country and where we need to go. I've got a varied life experience. I spent 7 years in the corporate world as a programmer analyst. I spent 7 years in the pro-life movement as a pro-life activist. And I spent 14 years as a small business owner. So I've spent my life in the private sector. And I might have more business experience than the entire Obama administration. I don't know. But, you know, I look at these things as an average working American. I'm not from the political class. Prior to 2008, I was a voter and had not been involved too much in politics. But once I ran for Congress, I felt like I couldn't just let it go, that the stakes right now are too high. And I felt like Lindsey Graham had to be challenged. I was the first one to enter the race to challenge him beginning on April 15th is when I announced. So we're a little bit more than halfway through. We're on the downhill side, and we're closing the gap on Senator Graham.
What are your most important principles?
Well, that's easy. I campaign on this. I talk about it all the time. I believe in the ideas and principles that have made this nation greater, derived from Christianity, capitalism, and the Constitution. I like to think of America and articulate this in terms of a triangle. I believe that the two sides of the triangle, one side is economics, and the other side is politics. That's capitalism and the Constitution. But the foundational side, which supports that, is what I call culture. You know, culture kind of identifies who we are as Americans. It's how we think, it's how we see the world. We have a unique American mindset and experience. And I believe that our culture has been permeated from the ground up with the principles and ideas from our Judeo-Christian heritage, from the Bible. Christianity and culture are not synonymous, but Christianity has infused our culture. It's given it the particular shape and the rise that it has. We've been losing that for a generation. You know, the primary determinants of culture are faith and family. Of course, we have arts and entertainment, we have media and education. Those are all prime components of culture. But people's religion and their family, that's where we get our values, our ethics, our morals, and our worldview in life. And faith and family in particular have been under attack in America since the 1960s.
What are the most important issues to you?
Well, that's easy. It goes back to the cultural foundation. You know, in 1962, the Supreme Court began to drive God out of the public square in America with its ruling on prayer in school. That's continued up to this present day. The assault upon religious liberty, the free exercise of religion in the public square, I mean, it just goes on nonstop. The other thing that began to happen in the 60s was this substitution of moral relativism for moral absolutes. In 1973, these two things came together, this driving God from the public consciousness, the bringing in of situational ethics and moral relativism, that's how we got to a place where Roe v. Wade could happen. And so we had Roe v. Wade in 1973. Now, here we are 40 years later, looking back on the cultural wreckage that has ensued from these movements that began in the 1960s. The bitter fruit, you know, has been borne. 40 years to the year later, we're now discussing what is the definition of marriage. You know, I believe there are moral absolutes. I believe in God. If there is a God, he does have commandments. And there's some things, really, that you don't get to vote on. Thou shalt not murder. What defines marriage? I mean, all societies for thousands of years have believed that marriage is what is revealed in the second chapter of Genesis, which is the union of one man and one woman in a permanent, public, and covenantal type relationship. We've got to be able to articulate these things and stand firm on these things if, as conservatives, and if, as Republicans, we're not willing to fight for the principles of pro-life and pro-family, then I believe the Republican Party will eventually cease to exist. The biggest problem facing America right now is we're losing our cultural identity. The culture is going to determine the future of this country. Now, think about it like this. I like to think of America as a ship, the greatest cruise line ever built, right? Some people might consider it to be the Titanic even. And it's easy for us as individuals to get involved in cabin life, doing all the activities on the ship. But at the end of the day, it really does matter where the ship's going. It matters where the ship's going. Well, our ship's going in the direction of secularism, it's going in the direction of socialism, and it's going in the direction of centralism, centralized power in the hands of the federal government. I believe most conservatives want to see the ship turned. They want us to see us return to limited constitutional government. They want us to see us to go back in the direction of capitalism as opposed to socialism. And they want to see a return to spiritual and moral values that come from the Bible, come from the foundational principles of our Judeo-Christian heritage. We've got to get the ship going in a different direction. And if we're going to do that, we've got to send people to Washington, D.C. who hold those core values as dear to them and things that they're not going to compromise on, that they're going to be willing to fight for.